Hello, marine biology students. In this video, we're going to be learning about ocean basins, the ocean floor, and how plate tectonics relates to ocean formation. So let's talk about the oceans on the surface of the planet Earth. It turns out that these oceans are actually all connected to each other, and we call this collected feature the world ocean. The world ocean is the dominant feature on the surface of planet Earth in terms of total area. In fact, 61% of the total area of the northern hemisphere is covered in ocean, and about 80% of the southern hemisphere is also covered in ocean. The world ocean is divided up into four large basins, and those are the Pacific, the Atlantic, the Indian, and the Arctic oceans. Now you may be saying, well, what's all this stuff about the seven seas and sailing the seven seas? Where does that come from? Well, our modern understanding of what the seven seas are include the Arctic Ocean, the North and South Atlantic, the North and South Pacific, the Indian Ocean, and the Southern Ocean. But it turns out that this phrase, the seven seas, has been around in many different cultures and from many different times. And in each of those cultures, the seven seas refer to different bodies of water. So there are different bodies of water for different cultures at different times. It's a bit surprising that this phrase has been around for so long and in so many places. So here we see a map of the Earth, one way of representing the Earth, and we can see the major ocean basins. We can see that the Pacific Ocean is the largest of the current ocean basins, but it is also an ocean basin that is shrinking, whereas the Atlantic Ocean basin is growing. Now the Southern Ocean may not be one you've really considered or thought about much, but if we look at our planet from the South Pole, we can see that surrounding Antarctica, there's an entirely open expanse of ocean that actually connects the Indian Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, and the Pacific Ocean all together. Now, looking at the North Pole, we can see that the Arctic Ocean actually covers over the North Pole itself and has connections both to the Pacific and the Atlantic Oceans. Now, another thing you may not be aware of is the general shape of Antarctica. And I remember hearing the shape of Antarctica described to me as being a duck shape. And since I've heard that, now I can't unsee it. So there you go. Antarctica is in the shape of a duck, and the Southern Ocean entirely surrounds it. Now I'd like to talk a bit about plate tectonics. So when we look at the Earth itself, the Earth is thought to have originated 4.5 billion years ago from dust accumulated from the Big Bang. Now, due to the heat associated with these events, the early Earth was likely molten. Meaning that the major components at that point were liquid. This allowed the materials of the Earth to settle by density. As the materials cooled, with the more dense materials settling down into the core. So the heavier materials settled deep into the Earth, whereas the lighter components ended up forming a thin crust on the top, and as that crust cooled, it became solid. Eventually, the Earth's oceans and atmosphere began to form. Now, the location of the Earth relative to the Sun allows for water to stay liquid. An essential substance for sustaining life as we know it. When we look at the layers of the Earth, we have the core, which is the innermost layer. It's an inner solid core and a liquid outer core. It's iron rich, iron and nickel. It's a very dense material. And then we have a mantle. Which are the middle layers, and they're semi-plastic compositions. What that means is that they're movable, they're flexible, they aren't fully liquid, and normally what we think of as lava, that's not exactly the same material that the mantle is made out of, but the mantle is thick and somewhat movable, so that's what we mean by semi-plastic. And then lastly, we have the crust, which are the outermost layers, the thinnest portion of the Earth. So here on this next slide, we can see a diagram of the Earth and its layers, with a core including both an inner core and an outer core, a lower mantle, an upper mantle, on which these lithospheric plates are found. And then we have the continental crust, the oceanic crust. These crust or plates are what make up the surface of the Earth. So the crust of the Earth is actually different below the oceans as compared to on the continents. The oceanic crust is made up primarily of a darker colored mineral known as basalt. It is denser than the continental crust, thinner than the continental crust, and also younger than the continental crust, with most parts of the oceanic crust being less than 200 million years old. Conversely, the continental crust is light colored. It's mostly composed of granite. As I had mentioned, it's less dense and actually thicker than the oceanic crust. Some continental crust is believed to be as old as 3.8 billion years old, and this is where our oldest fossils and oldest evidence of life are found. In this table, we can see some of the characteristics comparing oceanic crust and continental crust, with the oceanic crust being denser, thinner, younger, darker, and possessing different elemental composition than the continental crust. Now, in 1912, the theory of continental drift was proposed by a German geologist named Alfred Wegener. Wegener suggested that all continents had been joined in a single supercontinent, which he named Pangaea. He proposed that Pangaea began breaking up 180 million years ago. Now, when he proposed this idea, it was not widely accepted at the time, and a large part of that is due to a lack of mechanism. He couldn't explain why it was that continents were moving, especially when, to everyone's observation, they seemed to be so solid and stationary and not moving in reference to each other. Well, plate tectonics explains the how behind Wegener's continental drift theory. Some of the major features of plate tectonics is that the Earth's surface is covered by a series of lithospheric plates. This is the crust that we were just mentioning. Also, that ocean floors are constantly moving. Spreading in the center and sinking at the edges and being regenerated. Within the mantle, there are convection currents. Beneath the plates, And this is what is causing these lithospheric plates to move on the surface of the mantle. It's the heat from the mantle that drives these currents. When we look at the map of the Earth, we can see some of these major lithospheric plates. At the boundaries between plates, there can be subduction, there can be moving together. These are going to be the sites of volcanism, of earthquakes. Also, at these plate boundaries, the plates may be moving apart from each other. And this is the case along most of the oceans. When we look at the sea floor, there are mid-oceanic ridges in most of the major oceans. And a mid-oceanic ridge, or a chain of submarine volcanic mountains that rise from the ocean floor. Now, while these chains of submarine mountains are mostly continuous, at somewhat regular intervals, the ridge is displaced by faults in the Earth's crust called transform faults. So instead of the plates moving directly away from each other, in this case, the plates slide past each other, and so what was a continuous mountain range can end up being broken up. Now, in the oceans, on the sea floor, sediment accumulates over time. What we see is that the sediment is thicker away from these mid-ocean ridges, and thinner, in fact, to the point of being non-existent, at the mid-ocean ridge itself. This means that the crust further away from the ridge is older. Here we see a map of the age of oceanic crust, and we can see these brighter colors, the reds and oranges and yellows, that denotes a younger age for those pieces of the crust. And so, we can see along the mid-ocean ridge, we have younger pieces of oceanic crust. And the farther you get from these mid-ocean ridges, the older the oceanic crust gets. Another thing that we can use to date oceanic crust are geomagnetic anomalies. At random intervals in the Earth's path, the Earth's magnetic field reverses, it switches polarity. What we would call magnetic north ends up becoming the south, and the south becomes the north. Now, this hasn't happened during recorded human observation while we've known about the magnetic field, but we can see clear evidence of this in the geologic past. And one of the places we can see that evidence is in the oceanic crust forming by these mid-ocean ridges. New rock forms from magma, and it records the orientation of the Earth's magnetic field at the time that the rock cools and forms. Studies of the seafloor have revealed stripes of alternating magnetization parallel to the mid-oceanic ridges. And we can see in this figure what we would consider our normal magnetic orientation versus reversed magnetic orientation. And as the magnetic orientation of the world flips, the polarization or the direction of the magnetic particles within the oceanic crust also flips. One of the last lines of evidence that supports plate tectonics are island arcs. These are chains of islands that are found throughout the oceans, especially in the Western Pacific. These island arcs are usually situated along the continental side of deep-sea trenches. These deep-sea trenches form when oceanic plate moves underneath neighboring plate, whether it's another oceanic plate or a continental plate. As these plates move under the neighboring plate, this subduction causes the trench, but it also generates earthquakes, it generates magma, it generates volcanic activity that can result in these island arcs. So these observations, along with many other studies of our planet, support the theory that underneath the Earth's crust is a layer of heated rock driving the creation of new ocean floor. So here we can see a oceanic plate subducting beneath a continental plate. And this is along the border of South America. We see the Andes are formed, the volcanic activity of that mountain range is because the Nazca plate, which is an oceanic plate, is subducting below the continental plate. We can also see this in the Aleutian Islands, which are off the end of Alaska. This island chain is caused by the Pacific plate moving beneath the North American plate. And again, earthquakes and magma formation and volcanic activity is caused by the subduction zone. And it's right on the continental side of an oceanic trench. So when we look at a map of the Earth's oceans and some of these major features, such as trenches and mid-ocean ridges, we can see that this theory of seafloor spreading at the mid-ocean ridges is accounted for, and the movement of these major lithographic plates also causes the movement of our continents. So this is the last video for this week. Thanks for your attention, and I'll see you in the next video.